Hello viewers, I'm Mamta. Today we'll be doing chapter 2, Self and Personality. Today we'll be discussing the post-Freudian approaches. Along with that, we'll be discussing the behavioral approach and the cultural approach. Let's start with the first approach, the Neo-Freudian approach. Now this approach is also known as the Neo-Analytic or post-Freudian approach because these psychologists were after Freud. Although they were followers of Freud, but they disagreed with certain concepts of Freud. Particularly, like Freud talked about the concept of id as important for personality, the Neo-Freudians talked about the concept of ego. Freud talked about the concept of unconscious as a very important determinant for personality, whereas Neo-Freudians focused on the conscious aspect of personality. Freud talked about the sexual instincts, whereas Neo-Freudian talked about the social cultural instincts, along with which they emphasized features of creativity and problem solving. Now let's start with the first Neo-Freudian, Carl Jung. Now Carl Jung's theory is also known as analytical psychology. Analytical particularly means here the opposites. So Carl Jung talked about the balance of two opposite forces into the personality. Here he focused on particularly collective unconscious, unlike Freud. Freud focused on personal unconscious, that is my own unconscious personality. Whereas Carl Jung said that unconscious transmits across generations. And how do we get to know that? We are aware of that by looking at a concept known as primordial images. Primordial images means a particular characteristic which passes on from generations, something which is already there in the form of symbols, traditional images, myths, symbols, for instance, Mother Earth, for instance, God. These are symbols which I particularly do not have in my unconscious. It is a part of collective unconscious. Now, Carl Jung also discussed when he talked about analytical psychology. He said that our self, since it has balance of the opposites, for instance, male and female balance out into the opposite pattern, that is what is analytical. So any force which balances out the two opposites results in the unity or oneness of the self. That is precisely what Carl Jung said. Now under primordial images, he gave one concept called archetypes. Archetypes is basically those symbols in the mythological stories that we have in our collective unconscious. Let's move on to the second Neo-Freudian, Karen Horney. Now, Karen Horney basically disagreed with Freud from his perspective of females. Now, Karen Horney said that the difference between the two gender is primarily cultural. It is what society grooms females as. That means both the genders cannot be superior or inferior as against the other. It is primarily what society teaches females to be. So here, Karen Horney talked about very optimistic view of human nature, unlike Freud, who talked about human nature as a very pessimistic or a very negative approach. Now here she emphasized also on the aspect of self-actualization and the aspect of growth. Same thing we'll be talking about a little later in detail also. Now here, she also said that personality is resulted from disturbed interpersonal relationships. And in fact, that can lead to many mental illnesses or disorders. Now, interpersonal relations, basically, she focused on parent-child interaction. For instance, a parent is very discouraging, very indifferent towards the child. So a child will have an impact on the personality because the child will become very insecure. And that is what Karen Horney called as the basic anxiety. Now this develops during childhood, where children, when they do not get a very supportive environment, a very warm environment in the family, they develop a basic anxiety, which later results in disorders. Let's move on to the next Neo-Freudian, who is Alfred Adler. Now, he basically focused on individual psychology. Individual particularly because his main focus was on everybody's life goals, everybody's aspirations. So, each individual has a purpose of life, a goal which motivates him, which provides him a support system which he works for. So every individual also has a concept of superiority or a concept of inferiority. Inferiority, simple as shame, embarrassment, guilt, rejection. Now, a lot of times when we look at people who are having some kind of handicap, for instance, somebody having a vision handicap cannot see. So that particular person will compensate for that inferiority through the other sense organs. So in this case, the sense organ of touch will be very good for this person for compensating for the vision loss. Now that is what Adler called as overcoming that inferiority complex and developing a superiority about yourself. He also discussed the behavior in general as very purposeful and goal-directed. So every behavior has to have a purpose. It is not random. And the purpose is to fulfill the life goal towards which everybody's lifestyle is built. Next Neo-Freudian that we have is Erich Fromm. Now, Erich Fromm was particularly focusing on social and cultural aspects of personality. So he said that the cultural elements or the cultural values like freedom, like justice, like responsibility, all of these needs result in a healthy personality. So he focused on culture influence on the person and person's influence on the culture in the vicious cycle where both of them influence each other in developing a healthy personality. So he obviously considered human beings as very social beings who are more oriented towards love for themselves and for other beings, and their characteristics develop from their social experiences. Let's move on to the last Neo-Freudian, who is Erich Erikson. Now, Erikson was very influenced by Freud, particularly in the stages of development. So Erikson talked about the psychosocial stages of development, where he talked about 8 stages. Now, development here means right from infancy to old age. So he covered infancy, childhood, young adult, adult, mid-age and old age, where he tried to introduce the 2 opposites, where one was a positive stage and the other was a negative aspect. Now, whenever anybody is developing, the person might be developing the positive aspect, another person might be developing the negative aspect. Now, particular focus for Erikson was on adolescence. So, for instance, the concept of identity and the concept of identity crisis. So, a healthy identity versus a crisis identity, that is what Erikson talked about. Now, one more aspect which Erikson focused was that development is a lifelong process and therefore we need to consider it in these particular stages. And unlike Freud, his emphasis was on rational, conscious and ego-related processes. Now, let's move on after covering the 5 Neo-Freudians to the criticism of psychodynamic theory. Now, this particular theory was criticized a lot in terms of certain characteristics. Let's look at that. First, it said these theories were particularly based on selective case studies and they lack rigorous scientific basis. Now, this basically presumes that Freud was only considering few cases where from those particular cases, he developed and formulated the theory. Now, since those cases were limited in number and those cases were not scientifically tested, that remains the biggest criticism for Freud. Let's look at the next one. He used small and atypical individuals as samples for advancing generalizations. Now, here again, if Freud was using very limited number of data and particular kind of individuals who were atypical, having certain set of characteristics, and then he generalized those to the population, again, that was considered unjustified. Let's look at the third one. The concepts are not properly defined, and it is difficult to subject them to scientific testing. Now, a concept like unconscious, a concept like progression, a concept like displacement, these concepts were not very clearly defined. For a layman to hear a concept like ego, it will be very confusing because the person will confuse it with a normal everyday concept of ego. So such concepts were very confusing and not accurately defined as per the critics. Let's look at the last one. Freud used males as prototypes of human personality development. He overlooked female experiences and perspectives. Now, this has been the major criticism. His own daughter criticized him for this, that why are you only looking at one particular gender and then you're applying it the same to all the genders, which is not fair again. So with that, we wind up criticism of Freud's theory. Now, let's move on to the topic of behavioral approach. Now, behavior per se is any reaction or any response to an outside stimulus. Now, this theory particularly talks about a stimulus or another stimulus or stimulus response. So it can be SS conditioning, which we call the first one, as classical conditioning by Pavlov, where he talked about the association between two stimulus. For instance, a normal response for a dog looking at food or hearing about food will be to salivate. That's one stimulus. The other stimulus, suppose light blinks and then food is given. So one stimulus and the other stimulus. That is classical conditioning. The second part of it is operant conditioning, given by Skinner, where he basically focused on the concept of reward and punishment. Reward was used in the concept of reinforcement, where a particular behavior has a higher probability of getting repeated in the future. So that is reinforcement. For instance, a particular child is told by the mother that if you do your homework, you will be allowed to go out and play. So his chances of doing the homework increases in future because he knows that if he does it on time, he will be allowed to go out and play. That is operant conditioning, where the person operates on the environment, where the person influences the environment. The third aspect of behavioral theory is talking about the social learning theory, which basically deals with the role models. Now, these role models inspire the person to behave in certain ways. This theory is given by Bandura. Now, winding up the theory particularly, we also try and influence the aspect of scientific measurement, because behaviorists talked about every behavior should be observable, measurable, and scientific. Only then it can be considered in the study. The last approach is a very simple approach, which is a cultural approach, talking about how a particular culture, lifestyle, rituals, values, ceremonies influences your behavior. We compare two behaviors here, industrial and agricultural behaviors. Industrial societies result in a socialization in which children are very, very independent. They are very achievement oriented, whereas the other agricultural is a more dependent culture. So every culture has a certain style of grooming people, and this is what we consider in the cultural approach. Winding up today's lecture, we've basically done and understood the aspect of how the Neo-Freudians differed from Freud. Covering that, we moved on to the behavioral approach, and finally we tried and understood the cultural approach. That's about it for today. Thank you.